Baruch Hashem. Good. Good, good, good. Baruch Hashem. So we are here in King David's tomb, Mount Zion, and we're learning the Kabbalah of the Ramhal. We're continuing from last week that we started to speak about the preparation for the prayer. We spoke about the washing the hands and going to the bathroom, and now we are in the second step or third step of the preparation of the prayer, which is the Tzitzit and the Tefillin. So let's read inside. In Derech Hashem, the fourth part, the sixth chapter, the fifth paragraph, it says like this. אמנם אחר זה יבואו שני מעשים אשר כבר הם בעצמם מכלל התרייג מצוות. There is two extra acts that they are part of the 613 מצוות ומתחברים עם תיקוני הנפילה, and they are connected with the preparation for the prayer, meaning it is also mitzvah by itself. That doesn't have to be part of the prayer. If you putting on tzitzit or tefillin in the middle of the day, so you're doing it as a mitzvah by itself. But when you're doing it in morning before the prayer, so it is fulfilling also the function as one of the 613 mitzvot, and also it is functioning as preparation for the prayer. ומתחברים עם תיקוני התפילה להשלמת העבודה היומית, והם הציצית והתפילים. נבהר בתחילה עניינם הפרטי, ואחר כך נבהר מדרגתם בתיקוני העבודה היומית שזכם. So, we're going to speak about those two mitzvot of the tzitzit and tefillin in those two aspects, as part of the 613 mitzvot, and individually, specifically, as a preparation for the prayer. עניין הציצית. So, we're starting with the tzitzit. הנה רצה אדון ברוך הוא שיהיו ישראל מתוקנים בכל בחינותיהם בענייני הקדושה. השם wanted עם ישראל to be מתוקן, to be fixed with all of the different ways of holiness, of קדושה. על כן נתן להם מצוות ולכל זמניהם כפי מקריהם. And this is generally the meaning of the מצוות that השם gave עם ישראל, that every time we have a different mitzvah to deal with, and in this way we are all the time we are connected to Hashem. The way that we are connected to Hashem every moment is with those mitzvot. Al ken natan lahem mitzvot lekol zmanim kol mikratem kedei sheyutaknu bekula, that they will be fixed in all of those ways. Vine michlal ma shel adam hu hamalbushim שהוא לובש, למען יתוקנו גם הם בקדושה. So, one of the things is the garments that the person is wearing. And Hashem wanted the garments to be also part of the קדושה, part of the holiness. וציווה שיושם בהם הציצית, ואז נמצאים נתקנים בקודש. So, when we are putting the ציצית in our garments, obviously, I'm not going into all of the laws of tzitzit now, but I just want to make sure that no one is about to put on tzitzit on his shirt and pants and all of those things. It's okay, that's not the purpose. You have to have the right garment to put on the tzitzit. Okay, so there's a different class about what is the right garment to put on tzitzit. But when we do that, when we have the right garment and we do the right tzitzit on top of that, so that makes that the garments that we were wearing have holiness within them, have kedusha. ועניין עמוק מזה נכלל עוד במצווה זו. There's another deep understanding in this specific mitzvah. והוא היות האדם נסתמן לאלוקיו כעבד לאדוניו. Which is the recognize the sign of Am Israel that they are slaves of Hashem. Why is that? הרי זה מכלל קבלת עולו יתברך והשתעבד אליו יתברך. Meaning, Hashem wants us to have a sign on ourselves that we are carrying with us, that we are his slaves. So when we are putting on the tzitzit, we are putting this sign on ourselves. Okay? And for this purpose, by the way, this is the reason for the Ashkenazim to put the tzitzit outside, that it will be shown outside, because we want to show that we are slaves of Hashem, so we don't want to hide the sign that Hashem gave us that we are His slaves. Okay? And if we are, I already said that, so I will add the other side, that the Sephardi custom to put on the tzitzit inside is basically according to the Arizal that says that the small tzitzit, the tzitzit katan, is symbolizing the internal light. So because it's symbolizing the internal light, it should not be revealed outside. Okay? So, now, if I already said that, so now I will explain according to the Ashkenazim how come it's not going against what the Arizal said. So there is two ways of how to put the tzitzit outside. There is the Hasidish way, if you saw that they are putting the tzitzit outside of the shirt, that the whole garment of the tzitzit is shown outside. Okay? And there is the Litvish way to put it inside of the shirt, and only the string goes out. Right? So if the garment is inside, and the strings are going outside, then you can say that what the Arizal meant is about the garment, that the garment itself is supposed to be inside, which is what we do. And the strings that are going outside, it's not going against what the Arizal said. Now, what the Hasidim will say, so they don't have a really problem because they are going with the coat all the time. So even though they're putting it outside of the shirt, but on top of that, they have also another garment. So still the tzitzit is inside, even though you can see a tiny bit of it, but mainly it is covered inside with the coat, so everybody are happy. Good. So now after we made everybody happy, so we can continue. הרי זה מכלל קבלת עולו יתברך ושתאבד אליו יתברך, הנה נתן לאדם להיות מתוקן את כל הבריאה כמבואר בחלק הראשון. And basically, we have to remember what we said before in the first part of the book, that when we are doing our tikkun, so we are doing the tikkun also for the entire creation, right? So every mitzvah that Hashem gave us, it's not only for our personal benefit, also for our personal benefit, but also for the general overall creation. Good. נמצא שהוא עובד עבודתו של הבורא יתברך ועוסק במלאכתו. Meaning, when we are doing those mitzvot, so we are constantly occupied in worshiping Hashem, in all different ways. שהוא העמיד הבריאה אשר ברא למצב הנרצה ממנו יתברך. And in this way, we are doing a constant process of tikkun, to fix the creation, to bring it to the perfection that was the original desire of Hashem within the creation. עולם זה יוצא ממעשה האדם ופעולותיו, שיפעל כפי התורה והמצווה שעליו. What is the amount that a person is able to bring the overall creation to its purpose? So it depends on the person, how much he's putting in. If he's putting in more efforts and more intention, and he learns about all of those different details in the highest level that he's able to, so then also the tikkun that he will bring, the amount of perfection that he will bring into the creation, it will be elevated according to that. אמנם כלל כל העבודה הזאת עומד על יסוד אחד, שהוא היות האדם עבדו של הבורא יתברך, שנמסר לו העניין הזה של תיקון הבריאה והופקד בידו. And a very basic fundamental that we have to remember, and as much as we will remember that and have that in mind, it will bring us, it will give us the strength to push the perfection that we are doing in the creation to another level, is to have in mind that we are slaves of Hashem. And all what we are doing, we're doing because it is His commandment. Meaning, in other words, if you're putting on the tzitzit in the morning, for example, we are speaking about the tzitzit, and you're doing it because that's your custom. You don't think about it. You just put it on without thinking. So then, you did the mitzvah, right? But you didn't do the maximum potential of perfection that is possible for you to do in this mitzvah. And if you will do the same act, but you will correct your thought to have in mind in that moment that you're putting on the tzitzit, that I'm doing now mitzvah because that's what Hashem commanded me, and I am His slaves, I am the Hashem's slave, and I want to do His will, I want to do His commandments. And then, in this way, you bending your heart to Hashem's commandment, to Hashem's will. Okay? And that is the way to get to the maximum potential of perfection that we can in every step that we do, through the day and through our life. Okay? And I want to add something extra that is a little bit out of the subject, but it's very, very important for everybody, that it's not only about mitzvot like tzitzit and tefillin. It's also, and a lot, about accepting Hashem's, the way, whatever Hashem is giving to us in our life. Okay? For example, a person made investment. He invested a big amount of money in a certain business, and he had in mind, he had the whole plan, what he's going to do with the profit, this, that, all kinds of good things, and then, didn't work. For some reason, he didn't think about it enough, something didn't work according to his plan, and the business didn't work, and he lost his money. So how a person like that feels? So normally, according to nature, a person is very frustrated. I wanted to do so many good things, and I had this plan, and I had this, and I had that, and I put so much effort, and I prayed to Hashem, and I wanted to do good, and Hashem prevented me from this goodness that I wanted to do with this money that I was about to make. This is the natural reaction. But if we are submitting ourselves to be slaves of Hashem, to bend our heart to His desire, so then the response should be, okay, Hashem, if you don't want me to do this business, you don't want me to be successful in this business, okay, so I accept it, that's what you want. To accept Hashem's will, even though we had some other idea that we thought it the best idea, but when Hashem is revealing to us whatever it is that He brings into our life, so it means that this is what Hashem wants us to deal with, and this is the best thing for us in the same moment to deal with, right? Because Hashem wants the best for us. So even though we might think otherwise, when we are accepting on ourselves the yoke of submitting ourselves to Hashem's commandment, Hashem's will, then we are doing the greatest tikkun for ourselves and for the creation. So it's about the mitzvot and also about other things that comes into our life. שעל כן הדבר הזה מצליח בידו. Meaning, the reason that we are able to do all of those different תיקונים in the creation is because it is Hashem's commandment. If a person would think to himself about idea, instead of tzitzit, he have an idea that he needs to take a tissue and to put it inside of his pocket in a way that it will be hanged out, and he will think that in this way he will bring tikkun to the creation. It won't bring tikkun to the creation because that's not what Hashem commanded. The reason that we can put the strings on our garment and it will make tikkun in the creation is because we are submitting ourselves to the desire of Hashem. If it would have been some other thing, that it's not what Hashem commandment, so it wouldn't do anything. The whole effect is because we're going according to the manuscript of Hashem. This is the guideline. This is the user manual, right? ומעשיו מגיעים להוליד תולדות אלה. The action is able to bring results if you're going according to the book of the rules, which is the Torah. Someone that you have very wonderful ideas, very nice theories. The world today is full of many people that have all kinds of nice ideas and theories about how to live life and all kinds of things like that. And it's all good and nice, but it doesn't bring the result. Why? Because it's not what Hashem commanded. Right? For me, a very good example, I think I spoke about it in the past, is communism. In the theory, I think that communism sounds very nice, very good. Everybody are partners, everybody are taking whatever they need, and they give whatever they can. So in the theory, it sounds like a perfect society. But practically, we see it doesn't work. It never worked. All of the countries that tried it, it never worked. But why? Because they're not submitting themselves to Hashem's desire. So it cannot work. Right? And the same thing about anything. There's many, many ideas today in the New Age, whatever it's called, New Age. Many good ideas, many nice, very wise people that have all kinds of good ideas. But all of those things, it by definition, it will not work if it's not according to the Torah. Only something that person will do with the connection to Hashem, with the connection to the Torah, only in this way it will work. And we see the results in the world. אולם כלל מציאות היות האדם מסע על האדם נקרא או לא התברך שעליו כי או לאדון על עבדו. Now, for many people it is very hard to accept this because they want to be independent. They don't want to submit themselves to the desire of anything else, even not to Hashem. I want to do what I want. I don't want anyone to tell me what to do. Right? It's a little bit childish, but most of the people in the world, that's basically what they say. Now, we see that practically the people that are not taking on themselves any yoke, any responsibility, so nothing happened with them. They stay in the same original spot of what they started, because they are not ready to take the responsibility. By the way, I had a nice idea, nice vote of Rav what's his name? I don't remember. Anyhow, he said, what is responsibility? Responsibility. That you have the ability to respond in the right way, this is responsibility. Very nice understanding of the word. Anyhow. Very good. I remember the name of the rabbi, I will say it. It says it brings redemption to the world. When you say something in the name of the person that said it, it's a way to bring the redemption to the world. So I try to remember the name. Anyhow. Maybe in the end of the class. שעל הדבר זה מצליח בידו ומעשיו מגיעים להוליד תולדות אלה. אולם כלל המציאות היות מסע זה על האדם נקרא או לא יתברך שעליו. כי או לאדון על עבדו. So like a master yoke on his slave, the slave naturally doesn't want to be a slave. He wants to be the master himself. He wants his master to be his slave. Right? That's the nature of the slaves, usually. Right? That's normal. Also, in this relationship of man and the Creator, most of the people, they want to be able to tell Hashem what to do. It's funny to say that, but this is the reality. Many people, they like it, they're looking for all kinds of tricks that Hashem will listen to what they want. Not to do what Hashem wants, that Hashem will do whatever they want. They want to be the master and they want Hashem to be their slave. It sounds a little bit crazy, but this is the reality of many, many people. And again, what brings the tikkun? What brings the perfection of the creation? When we are accepting the reality as it is, that Hashem is the master and we are the slaves. This is the right way of how to live our life, and as much as we are accepting this, we can be more happy, right? Like in the parable of real master and real slave. So if the slave is a rebellion, is fighting against his master, so the master have to punish him, to put him in place. But if the slave is a good slave, and is so there's a possibility to create a beautiful relationship between the slave and the master. And then the slave can have a very, very good life, even though he's a slave. There's a statement in the Gemara, it says, after the Malka Malka, meaning a slave of a king is a king. What does it mean? When a slave of the king, you have a symbol of the king, and he's going in the market, people see him, they have to respect him, because he's representing the king. If someone will insult someone that he have the symbol of the king on him, he's embarrassing the king. The king is in the palace. But if someone is mistreating his slaves, so it's like his insult for the king. Right? So there is, when the slave is a good slave, and he's accepting on himself the yoke of being a slave, he's not trying to rebel, he's not trying to fight against it, so then he have the prestige of being a slave of the king. Okay? דבר זה מתחזק על ידי פרטים ידועים שתלעו בהם האדון ברוך הוא, מכללם הרישום והציון בציון זה של הציצית. So there's a few things that makes the difference about those things that we just spoke about, and one of the main things is the tzitzit. Right? This is the reason, by the way, that the Chazal, the sages, are telling us that within the tzitzit we have a certain quality of all of the 613 mitzvot. Why? Because we're putting on ourselves a sign that we are ready to do all of the mitzvot. If I'm accepting on myself that I'm the slave of Hashem, so it means I'm doing Hashem commandment. Whatever I have the ability to do, I do. So even though I don't have the ability to do all of the 613 right now, for example, all of the things of the Bet Mikdash, of the Kohanim, I can't do right now, right? But I'm saying a statement. When I'm putting on the tzitzit, I'm saying a statement that I'm ready to do it. If it will be in my hands, if I'll be able to do it, I will do it. So, because I'm ready to do it, it's as if I did it. It gives a certain quality of as if I already did all of the 613 mitzvot. אמנם מלבד היות הדבר הזה מצווה תמידית. עשו ממנו חכמנו זכרונם לברכה, תיקון מתיקוני התפילה. So, again, we have the mitzvah of the tzitzit as a constant mitzvah anytime. Anytime. The tzitzit katan that you're putting under the garment, you can put it on also within the night, you can sleep with it. I don't recommend to take a shower with it, but if you really want, you can even take a shower with it. Okay? You can do it all the time. But besides of the fact that it is a constant mitzvah that you can do all the time, there is a special quality when we're doing the tzitzit before the shacharit. והוא להיות מתעטף בתלית להתפלל בו, והתיקון הוא קבלת העול שזכרנו להיות בכוח זה תופס ואוחז במלאכתו יתברך, דהיינו תיקון העולם כמו שזכרנו. So when we are putting on ourselves the tzitzit, tlit, before the shacharit, so we're doing all of this tikkun, we are awakening all of the what we just spoke about, we're awakening those qualities as a preparation for the shacharit. So then it brings the shacharit to a much greater height. Because we made this preparation of putting on the tzitzit. Okay. So basically this is about tzitzit. Obviously there's a lot about tzitzit that the Ramhal didn't speak about here, but we keep it in this level. And another time, a different book, a different occasion, Mezrat Hashem will speak about other secrets of the tzitzit. Now we're moving along to the tefillin. אך עניין התפילין הוא גדול יותר מן הציצית בהרבה. Now, although what we said about the tzitzit, we have the same qualities about the tefillin. But tefillin, it has even greater qualities. even higher. והוא כי נתן הבורא יתברך שמו לישראל שיהיו ממשיכים עליהם המשך ממש מקדושתו יתברך ויתעטרו בו. With the tefillin, we are actually bringing the holiness of Hashem to ourselves. When we're putting on tefillin, we are bringing the holiness of Hashem on ourselves. באופן שכל בחינותיהם הנפשיות והגופניות יתייחסו תחת האור הגדול הזה ויתוקנו בו תיקון גדול. In other words, when we are putting on tefillin, we are putting all of our being, physical, emotional, and spiritual, under the light of Hashem. We bring it all within the light of Hashem. The concept is a little bit hard because everything is within the light of Hashem anyhow. Right? It cannot go out by definition. So what does it mean to bring it in? It's already in. Right? You understand the problem? So the answer is that when we are doing that, it comes into our consciousness. Okay? We're there anyhow. But when we are doing the mitzvah of the tefillin, so it brings into our awareness the fact that we are within the light of Hashem. We are completely immersed within the light of Hashem. And this is something that is very, very important. באופן שכל, כן. הוא מה שאמר כתוב, וראו כל עמי הארץ כי שם השם נקרא עליך, תלה העניין במצווה זו בכל הלכותי הפרוטותיה. There's a pasuk that says in the Torah that the nations will see that the name of Hashem is called upon you, meaning upon Am Yisrael. And when that is happening, when is that? That is when Am Yisrael is doing the mitzvah of the tefillin. Okay? Says it. By the way, I'll tell you a little story. I see people are a little bit sleepy, so a story is a good thing to fall asleep, and also is a good thing to wake up. So now we'll use the story to wake up. So there's a story about the Baal HaTanya. You heard about Baal HaTanya? Rabbi Shneur Zalman Miladi. The first, in Chabad they call him the Alter Rebbe. The first Rebbe of Chabad. I don't know if he knew that he was the first Rebbe of Chabad, but anyhow, he was a big man. He was a big rabbi. So one time, there was some threat of non-Jews that wanted to do something to the Bet Knesset, wherever he was praying, and he went outside with his talit and tefillin, and they saw him and they got scared and they ran away. So the students, they said, Rabbi, what happened here? Like, why? He said, what do you want? This is what it says in the Torah. That the nations will see that the name of Hashem is called upon you, and they will fear from you. And the sages say that in the Gemara of Brachot, they say that this pasuk, it means about the tefillin shebarosh, the tefillin of the head. So I went outside, they saw me with the tefillin in the head, so they got scared and they ran away. Okay, very nice story, Rabbi, but they also saw us and they didn't get scared. We also had the tefillin on our head. So what's the difference? So the Baal HaTanya, he told him, no, you missed the point of what the statement of Chazal. It says, Elu tefillin shebarosh, the tefillin that are on, not on the head, in the head. Tefillin shebarosh, in the head. He was precise about the words, the way that it says it in the Gemara, it is like it is says that tefillin should be in the head. So he said, because I have the light of the tefillin in my head, then it works. The quality, this gula of the tefillin works. But for you, you're just putting it on your head. It's not going in. The light doesn't penetrate. So you have to know how to bring the light into your head, and then it will activate the special segula of the tefillin. So maybe after today's class, we will have a little bit more inspiration about how to bring the light of the tefillin into our head. Omnam shnei evarim roshiim nimtzayim ba'adam. We have two main organs within human body. And this is also physical, emotional, and spiritual. בהם הנשמה מתגברת תגבורת גדול. In those two organs, the neshama, the soul, have the main strength within the body. והם המוח והלב, the brain and the heart. וציווה הבורא יתברך שימשך האור הזה אל המוח תחילה, על ידי תפילה של ראש, ויתוקן בו המוח והנשמה. So when we are putting on the tefillin of the head, what is happening? We're bringing the light of Hashem with the tefillin to our brain, and then again we have within the brain we have the connection to the neshama. So we are connecting the light of Hashem to our neshama. ויתפשט אחר כך על הלב על ידי התפילה של יד שכנגדו. And when we are putting the tefillin of the hand, so the tefillin of the hand, it should be in the same height of the heart, right? So from the tefillin of the hand, we are affecting the heart, and the light of Hashem penetrates into the heart, and also there, we have, there's the second organ that is connected to Hashem's light, Hashem to the neshama, connecting between Hashem's light and the neshama, in our soul. ויתוקן גם הוא בו. ועל ידי זה נמצא האדם כולו בכל בחינותיו, נכלל תחת המשך הקדושה הזאת ומתעטר בו. And then, when a person have those qualities of the tzitzit, the tefillin of the hand, the tefillin of the head, he brings himself to be immersed to the light of Hashem, to be completely within the light of Hashem. ומתחדש קדושה רבה, and that will bring him to very high levels of holiness. אמנם פרטי עניינים שונים נמצאים בתנאי המצווה בכל חלקיהם כולם, עניינים מצטרכים להשלמת התיקון נרצה בכל חלקיו, כפי מחלקות בחינותיו של האדם. And there is many many details about the tefillin, how it should be, and all kinds of different tefillin, and there's a lot to speak about, and we're not going to go on to all of those details, but I want to say that some people, they don't understand why it is so important to have that feeling that it will be in this shape, in this way, why it should be written by a special person, and so on and so forth. So I heard from a big rabbi, Rav Kohn, he was raised up here in Yerushalayim, but he's a leader of a community in Melbourne, Australia. So I heard from him that today in our generation it's very easy to understand why it's so important every letter of that tefillin, that it will count as a good tefillin, as a kosher tefillin. He said it's the same thing about phone. If you have a phone, that everything is good, but there's one wire that is misplaced, the phone doesn't work. It's useless. You can't call from that. Everything is good, but you have something small, tiny thing that is out of place. The whole thing doesn't work anymore. So he said the same thing is about tefillin. If you have one letter that is touching another letter, tiny bit, the whole tefillin is pasul. Even though it looks very nice and it has a nice box and everything is good, but it's not good. You cannot say bracha. It's not kosher tefillin. So same thing that we understand this about electronics in our generation. So the same thing is about tefillin. One time I was praying in Mincha and Kever David with the tefillin of Shimush Rabbah, like the custom of the Arizal. When I put it out, so there was an Indian guy that came in to the Kever David, King David's tomb, and he looked on the tefillin, like I think maybe it was the first time he saw tefillin in his life. Like, and I saw that like in his eyes, like what is that? So I told him, this is spiritual technology. Feeling for me, that's the way that I present it. This is spiritual technology, the secret, one of the secrets of the Jewish people. So, after we understand that, okay, let's continue another paragraph. הנה נצווינו להתעטר בעיטור זה כל הימים, חוץ מימי הקודש. Now, a person might say, if it is so good, so I should put also tefillin in Shabbat, in Yom Tov, because it's already holy, and I will make it more holy. So the answer is no. You can't oversmart Hashem. Hashem gave us the tefillin, it's called ot. Ot, it means a sign. It's a sign of for ourselves, and it's a sign of the covenant between us and Hashem. But the Shabbat, or Yom Tov, according to Zohar, also Chol HaMoed is also included in Yom Tov. Those days, the holiness of those days is the sign. That is the sign. So therefore, you don't put a sign on a sign. This is the sign. So in Shabbat, we don't put on tefillin. In Yom Tov, we don't put on tefillin. In Chol HaMoed, according to the Kabbalah, according to the Zohar, you don't put on tefillin. There is a custom in the Ashkenaz world to put on tefillin privately, but we'll speak about it another time. מצדם מתדרים ישראל ביתוריהם בלי השתדלות אחר, מה שאין כן, שאר הימים שאי אפשר להשיג היתורים, אלא בהשתדלות הזה. Meaning, in those days of Shabbat and Yom Tov, we accepting the connection of Hashem with the holiness of the day. We don't need something extra. But in the weekday, that the spiritual level is much lower, then we're putting on the tefillin, and that's what makes the connection. That's what gives us the elevation to connect to Hashem. וגם אחר השתלות עצמו, אין מעלת האיתור מושג בו כמעלת האיתור הנמשך מאליו בימי הקודש. The Ramhal is saying even more than that, that the Kedusha and the connection that happens in those days of Shabbat and Yom Tov and so on, it is greater than the connection of the tefillin. So according to that, when you're putting the tefillin in those days, you are lowering yourself. You're not uplifting yourself, you're putting yourself downwards, because you are pushing away the sign of the day, and you're taking the sign of the tefillin. So you took something that is higher, that is greater, and you put on yourself the tefillin that is giving you also connection, but it's not the same level. אלא פחות מנו הרבה. מנהם דברים כולם בכל גבוליהם משוערים מן החוכמה העליונה, כפי משהו יותר נאות. And once again, all of those different set of rules of when it applies and how to do it and so on, all of those things is basically according to the wisdom of Hashem, so we cannot oversmart Hashem and say that we can do better than that. What Hashem gave us, this is the maximum. Okay, so continuation, to be continued tomorrow, Bezrat Hashem. Do you have Siddur over there? No, the English Zichron David. Yeah, thank you. So, good, thank you. So in the Zichron David, we were speaking about Shabbat. We were speaking about the night prayer of Shabbat specifically, and I told you the secret about the three times Vayechulu, and each one of those three times Vayechulu, we have three times Shvi'i, and altogether it is nine times that we are drawing the light of Shabbat, because Shvi'i is Shabbat, right? So we're saying nine times we say Shvi'i within the night of Shabbat. And in this way, we are drawing the light of Shabbat on ourselves. Right? So that's what we were discussing last time. Obviously, there's a lot to speak about the prayers of Shabbat, but I want to continue. One thing I want to add, I'm now in the Siddur in page 392. So there is a special blessing that we say after the night prayer on Shabbat. It's called Me'ein Sheva. Okay, what does it mean, Me'ein Sheva? There is, and in a regular Amidah, we have 18 blessings, which is really 19, but we count it as 18. Originally it was 18, then they added one more, so it's 19. But in Shabbat, we have seven blessings. We have the first three and the last three are set. We say every time the same thing. First three, last three. But in the middle, instead of the 13 blessings, in a weekday, we have one blessing of Mekadesh Shabbat. Right? So, we have three, and one in the middle, so it's 7. Right? That's the Amidah of Shabbat. In the night prayer, after we finished, the Chazan is doing something that is like a repetition. Usually we don't have repetition in the night. We have repetition in Shacharit, we have repetition in Mincha. In the night, in Arvit, we don't have repetition. Only in the night of Shabbat, Yom Tov, we have repetition. It's called Me'ein Sheva. Okay? So what is the reason of this Me'ein Sheva? So here, I didn't say it, Bezrat Hashem, in the next edition, we'll have it. This is the, it's, there's a secret that it says in the Gemara that the sages have did the tikkun of Me'ein Sheva for the people that come late. Okay, this is the words of the Gemara. For the people that come late, meaning, in other words, in the old times, what I'm saying now is before I'm saying the secret. Yeah, this is the simple understanding. First you have to have the basic pshat, then we can go another level, another step afterwards. So, in the old times, people didn't have sidurim like that, nice sidurim. People had to know the prayer by heart. So they practiced from their youth, from their childhood, and they know everything by heart. And if someone doesn't know, so what he does? He has to rely on the Chazan, on the Shliach Tzibur. So the leader of the congregation is doing a repetition for those people that are they don't know how to pray, so he's doing for them. This is the simple understanding. So if there is people that they had to walk in the field until the last moment just before Shabbat comes in, and then in the last moment they run back to the house to change their clothes, and then they coming back to the Beit Knesset, but they, what to do? It's already after the time that the people all prayed, right? So for those latecomers, there is the repetition of the Shabbat, in Shabbat night. Okay, this is the simple understanding. Now, I want to give you a secret about this. So, like I said, when we started to speak about Shabbat night, I said that there is, within the whole process of Shabbat, from Friday morning until Shabbat comes in, we have elevation after elevation after elevation after elevation. Okay? Now, obviously, not all the people are in the same level. Right? Not all the people are in the same level. So each person is experiencing the elevation of Shabbat in a different way, according to his level. Wherever a person is getting a little bit extra. One time I heard a rabbi that he said, why the non-religious people, they like to do all kinds of activities, especially in Shabbat. They like to go to the beach, especially in Shabbat. They like to cut their lawn, especially in Shabbat. Why? Because even though they don't have anything to do with Torah, with the spirituality of Shabbat, but they feel special pleasure in Shabbat, when whatever they do. So a person that what he likes to do is to go to the beach, he will have special enjoyment if he's doing it in Shabbat. Because he have, obviously, if he will keep Shabbat properly, he will have much greater joy and much greater pleasure. But even in things that are nothing to do with religion, you can feel extra pleasure and extra joy in Shabbat. So those people that the experience of the pleasure of Shabbat is very low, because they are not connected to the holiness of Shabbat. So there is a special tikkun for that within the prayer of Shabbat. And this is the Me'ein Sheva. This is the secret of the Me'ein Sheva. Meaning, when we say the latecomers, it means those neshamot of Jews that their elevation, they're experiencing the elevation of Shabbat very late. They have a big delay. So they didn't have it in Friday morning. They didn't have it in, they didn't go, they didn't do Shnai Mikav Echadagum. They didn't go to the mikveh. They didn't have special dressing for Shabbat. So all of those things that we just explained in the last couple of weeks about how to experience this elevation of Shabbat, so they don't have it. So when they feel it, only when Shabbat really comes in and it's already the holiness of Shabbat. So what is that? Shabbat night, when it's already night. Shabbat already came in. So then, when we're saying this blessing of Me'ein Sheva, so we can have in mind that this is to give some taste of the holiness of Shabbat for all of those Jews all around the world that they don't have the privilege to keep Shabbat properly and to experience the holiness of Shabbat properly. So we're saying this prayer for them, that they will have something, little experience of Shabbat, that the light of Shabbat will penetrate to their hearts. And this is something that is very, very important and very good to have in mind. And Bezrat Hashem, like I said, Blineda will have it in the next edition. Now, after we finish the what is called Shabbat service, we finish the whole thing. There is the song of Bar Yochai, but I'm not going to explain now the song of Bar Yochai in Shachta Ashrecha. Basically, we got to what happens when you're going back to the house in Shabbat night. Okay, so there's a whole ceremony that is, there's a big difference between the regular customs and the customs according to the Kabbalah. When a person goes back to his house in Shabbat night. So I will tell you about it, and I'm not saying that everybody that wants to follow this way of the Kabbalah have to do all of that at once. Okay? I'm saying it over as that you will have it as a background knowledge, for there is a custom like that in the world, and whoever wants to get into that and to be involved with that, so whatever is ready to do, do it. Okay? But don't try to jump in and to take the whole bundle altogether. Usually people are trying to jump too high, so they fall down. So, okay, so just take it slowly. Anyhow, first thing that everybody agrees, when you're coming into the house, you have to say Shabbat Shalom. Okay? It's except of it's that it's nice to greet the whoever is inside of the house, even if there's no one in the house. Okay? Even when the house is empty. You're coming into the house in Shabbat night, you say Shabbat Shalom. Okay? This is to bring the holiness that you bring with you from the Beit Knesset into the house. Okay? That's the first thing. Now, according to the Arizal, there is a way to have 12 breads on the table of Shabbat. Okay? It will be a little bit difficult to explain. Maybe we'll get to that tomorrow. Okay, tomorrow I will explain more about the 12 breads. But it should be that the person is coming back to the house. There's already, the table is set, and there is 12 breads on the table, and he should have the kiddush cup and the wine, grape juice. Many people using grape juice. It's better to use wine, but if it's hard for you, so use grape juice. And so you're coming in, you stand in the place where you're going to do the kiddush. Okay? Then you go around the table. According to the Kabbalah, you go around the table one time, and then you should have two bundles of hadassim. Myrtles. Two bundles of myrtles. Yeah, like in Sukkot, the myrtles, hadassim. Mm-hmm. Yeah. So you have in each bundle you have three branches of hadassim, and you tie them together before Shabbat. This is yeah.